This family in particular, it feels a little bit like pre-Honey Boo Boo, like without the charm and with drugs.
Are you sick of people talking to you yet?
No. No, I mean, I'm happy to get the movie out there as much as I can.
It's almost a full year of this you've been going through.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we've all been on the road together, so that's been the really nice part.
So I read a story, I don't know where it was, online or something, and it seemed like they spent like 3 or 4 different ways of saying out that you were hot.
Oh.
And this was their primary focus of the piece. It was very strange, actually.
I don't know what piece it was, but I'll send it to my mom.
So mom doesn't know? She needs a little memo on this?
Yeah, oh, definitely, definitely.
So it's been that glamorous? Is that the...
No, it's been, I mean... It's been really fun being on the road. I wouldn't call it glamorous, but it's more, we're all together. We ride around in a van together and then talk about the movie and then go out and I watch them eat Chinese food.
So you don't eat Chinese food? Is that what you're...
They eat a lot more than I do. So I just, after a point, I just hang back and watch.
So you've had Chinese food in a lot of different places.
Oh, definitely. It's all, yeah, absolutely.
It's a theme.
Yeah.
Beast of the Chinese Wild will be the sequel, I guess.
Yeah, absolutely.
So this all started as a play of yours?
It did. I wrote a play about me and my dad after he got sick and how our relationship changed, how I got stronger in a lot of ways, and how our relationship got stronger, but it had to really go through some hard times first. So that was the focus of the play. And then Ben came to me with the idea of taking those characters and that story and putting it in South Louisiana. Mm-hmm. So that's when we started writing the movie together.
So how different did it feel after a while? I mean, it's not exactly what that is.
Oh, no, absolutely. I mean, it felt like we were writing about a very new place. We moved down to a fishing marina in Pointe-aux-Chenes and spent a lot of time just listening to people talk and going out on boats and just exploring everything we could, and then really making these characters a part of this place and making the bathtub, which was this world we'd created, but it was based so strongly on our experiences in South Louisiana that making it a third character in the story, it seemed like.
So it was like a whole nother thing, really? I mean, is it...
Yeah, it feels like a whole... It felt like those characters... to me stayed the same. I think the characters gained depth. I think that relationship gained depth. And then it was really creating a new story and a new world with those characters.
Hmm. So what was the, was there ever a point where it didn't feel quite like you were doing something that was right? Or was it the adventure of going off and doing this thing for film that you haven't really done before?
Oh, no. Yeah, it was great fun the whole time. I mean, we had no expectations other than to make the best movie we could. And Ben is such a pleasure to work with that it just felt like making something you really like, that you really love to do with your best friend. So there was never any pressure more than to do the best job that we could.
So where did that relationship come from?
Oh, Ben and I have known each other, I want to say since we were 13. We both won a playwriting contest, and we were nerds together.
So you've just been hanging out for all those many years?
All those many years, yeah. We'd make each other mixtapes. He introduced me to Nick Cave. I introduced him to Graham Parsons and a lot of really, really fine country music. And he'd send me his movies, his short movies that he'd make, and I'd send him the stories and plays I would write. And we always had this really wonderful sense of bouncing things off each other. And it wasn't until I sent him Juicy and Delicious, the play, that we really found something we thought we could both work on and create together.
So was it always the idea that you might be a playwright and he might be a director, or were there...
I think for both of us, yeah, it was what I always wanted to do, and he always... I think he's a really strong musician as well, but he had such an affinity and such a gift for filmmaking that was evident so early on that I always thought that was how he would end up.
And being a playwright for you, what was that all about?
Oh, I just always have loved to do it. I love reading them. I love the different ways that you can make theater on a stage and off a stage, and just the different forms it can take is so exciting to me. And it's also cheap to do compared to even visual art or compared to film. So it's just always been a great love that I've had.
So was it something you just, is there a moment when you clamped down and decided, okay, I'm going to be a playwright, this is my life, this is what my destiny is, or?
Yeah, it never felt so serious. It was always more, I love doing it, and this is what I do whenever I'm not working.
Mm-hmm. So you were working to survive, and...
Yeah, I mean, every theater artist whichever person in New York does. So I would waitress, and then I would write when I wasn't waitressing.
So did it, before this adventure took off, was it a workable profession for you? Was it a career that was paying the rent, or were you still...
Oh, no, I was waitressing. I don't think playwriting itself ever pays the rent for anybody. Either you teach or you write films or you do something else, but playwriting is never expected to pay the bills. So for me, there was always this wonderful freedom of... I just had no expectation that it would do anything for me other than give me joy and fulfillment in doing it.
So has that changed with all of this?
Well, I can write full time now. I sold another play to work as a movie, so I'm able to write all the time now, which is incredibly fortunate.
And how's it going? I mean, you've also spent a lot of time promoting the movie, so.
I've been doing that a lot, but it's been good. I mean, I've always been able to get up early in the morning, so I can just do that before I go introduce the film.
So is that your strategy for writing, is that you have a set amount of time and you sit and you write no matter what?
Yeah, always. I get up at 5 these days. It used to be when Ben and I were trading the script back and forth, I would get up at 4 because mm-hmm. that would be around the time he'd go to bed, so he'd send me his pass at around 3:30, 4, and then I'd get it as soon as I woke up and I could work all day and then send it back to him. So we had a really quick turnaround. Mm.
So under the circumstances, were there things where you were writing things that you didn't know whether you could make them happen? Or did Ben just always say, okay, write whatever you think and let's try it. We'll figure it out how to make it work.
Yeah, he very early on, because I think I was so sensitive to how little of a budget there would be, and I didn't even know what it would be, but I asked him if I should think about what would be impossible to shoot, what would be expensive, what would be potentially dangerous, and he always said just write whatever you want and we'll figure it out. And we have such a good friendship and a strong trust of each other artistically that I always knew he would tell me if he couldn't do something, and he's never not been able to do something.
Well, it seems like the movie is more complex, would have been more complex to shoot than what your play probably was.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, there was this, because he gave me that freedom and that permission, I think it just felt, it was just really delightful to do. I mean, it was really enjoyable and a fun time. It never felt, it was difficult if we, sometimes there were scenes that didn't work and we would spend a long time really figuring that out because we both had a really high standard for how we wanted it to be, but it was really fun to do.
And were you there for production through the whole thing?
I was, yeah. I was really fortunate to be able to be on set the entire time. So I'd go back and forth from the bayou to the special effects unit up in New Orleans. Uh-huh. Special effects being the pigs, but, you know, loosely called special effects.
So fun, or was that stressful, or was there much rewriting as you went, given the tight schedule?
There was a little bit of rewriting in the first couple of weeks, just dialogue changes here and there. But no, for the most part, it felt like... It was just so exciting to watch this all come to life and watch so many people now bring their expertise and their passion, be it art department, the cinematography, how they talked about even the acting coaches, how they all brought their gifts to the project to really tell this story. So it was incredibly humbling and really, it was just a joy to watch.
So has your family always been supportive of the idea of you being a playwright or now a screenwriter?
Yeah, I mean, I think they're pleasantly surprised by the whole thing, but you know, we always were told to just do what we love and to work everything, you know, work everything you have for it. So, mm-hmm.
So that was the standard, was that whatever it was you wanted to do, that as long as you did it full force.
Yeah, you go full measure, like they say, and you know, work as hard as you are able to, work harder than you think you can, and mm-hmm. I think we've all done okay because of that. My parents set the bar pretty high, but I think we did.
Where did they set it?
Well, they're just pretty tireless. I mean, my dad does a lot of pro bono law, criminal law stuff. He does a lot of criminal law death penalty cases that he does, usually, I think, out of a huge amount of kindness and goodwill and morality. My mom helps him and also paints. So I've always seen them. I saw her be able to really balance art and how she made a living. And I saw my dad just be able to work tirelessly at something that isn't always pleasant. I mean, usually isn't. And mm-hmm. just because he thinks it's the morally right thing to do.
And none of you got roped into being lawyers? That was not a family.
My brother is actually in law school, so one of us did. But I thought it might be something. I mean, constitutional law is really interesting to me. Criminal defense law is really interesting to me. But I don't know if I have the heart for it.
Yeah. But do you see playwriting as a helping profession?
I don't know. I mean, I'm not going to be arrogant and say it's as important as pro bono criminal defense law. I do think the art that I've seen, I receive a lot of joy from, and I receive a lot of guidance from in my own life. But I think it's important. Mm.
So how did Sundance fit into your life? Are you part of the Sundance family on some level before all of this happened?
We did the Sundance Labs pretty early when we had this huge, I think the script is about 300 pages. I mean, the subplots of a Russian novel, more characters than a Russian novel. It was insane, the script that we brought to the labs. But they really taught us early on about distilling the story, about economy of language, about structure. And that was so invaluable to me because, especially coming from the theater, you don't need the same level of structure that you do when you're building mm-hmm. a screenplay. And then I was fortunate to come back for the summer labs to do it again, and then to watch Ben go through the directing lab, which was the first time I got a sense of what the next couple of months would be. When I watched him change from my co-writer to my director, that was a huge wake-up call in terms of what we were making was gonna be.
And in terms of screenwriting, how big a transition was that for you?
It felt, once I learned some of the principles, and that took me a while, mm-hmm. then that same freedom can be there. But it did I had to watch a lot of movies. I mean, because I didn't grow up watching that many. So I basically took Ben's Wesleyan film syllabus and devoured it. And then he made me a film list, which of his own movies. My Sundance advisors gave me a watching and reading list. So it was a couple of months of just binging on movies and instructional material and taking scripts apart, putting them back together, really going through and labeling everything. But it always felt, again, there was never a pressure in it other than to do the best work I could. So it was really fun. It was exciting. It was challenging. Sometimes it felt like doing a puzzle.
Well, the script, even as it is now, having seen the movie, is not structurally harsh, I would say. One way of putting it, and it does feel very free-form and open. Obviously, it had to be shot and put together and everything else for it to work, so there was structure there. But, I mean, was that a structure that was added to something that was already that way? Was it going towards structure and then opening it up after you kind of set the infrastructure? Or?
Well, there's structure in the script in terms of just being at Blueprint. I mean, I think that was a really important lesson for me to learn very early on, was it had to work to support the story just structurally very quickly. To me, it's always felt pretty tight. There were definitely moments of, I wasn't sure exactly what Ben was going to do in those moments of the mother and the woman she finds in Elysian Fields and Hush Puppy dancing. I wasn't sure how long that would be. I wasn't sure, you know, just, I wasn't sure the camera angle or even what that would look like. I just knew that I wanted her to hold Hush Puppy while she dances with her. So there were certainly moments where I knew Ben had it and I could just write, they dance together and just, you know, walk away. And then there were moments that were very tightly structured, and how she says things and what's said is very mm-hmm. important.
But so is the feel of the movie the feel you felt as a screenwriter? I mean, did you feel like, I mean, obviously everybody talks about making a film or refining a film in post, but I mean, is that part of the story here, or does it feel very much like the thing you were working on all that time?
It feels to me like what Ben and I were working on. It feels like the story that we were telling each other back and forth in those very early conversations, the overnight and early morning conversations. Just the story of Hush Puppy and her dad learning to take care of each other. The story of Hush Puppy learning to that she's never really alone in the world. That felt that's been a continuity since the beginning.
And the rawness of the film is something you wrote into it?
Yeah, I mean, I think we couldn't help it. I think it's something we're both so passionate about and so probably emotional about. I mean, I have this great relationship with my family. It wasn't necessarily something I never saw really turning out this way. There were times I wasn't sure how long I had my dad around. I think for Ben, just documenting and looking at these vanishing cultures and for both of us, just questioning what you hold on to when you're losing everything was just so vital to both of us, because we're both at an age now where you start to see your parents getting old for the first time, and you never think, I had never really thought about that.
So does the story, do the stories you move forward on from here, do you think they'll be significantly different? Do you think this experience is part of changing who you are as a playwright and as a writer in general?
That's a good question. I feel like the same person, maybe a little more confident of that certain stories are interesting and compelling. I think very early on when I was just writing the play, and Ben, even when Ben came to me about turning it into a movie, my first thought was who would want to watch this? I mean, this is basically my diary. Who's interested in this? Mm-hmm. And I think it taught me that if you write about something that's emotionally real for you and the truth, if you write the truth of your heart and what you're thinking about and what you're feeling, other people will connect with that in some way.
So have you done the rounds in Hollywood?
I've met a lot of people. I've met some really interesting, fun people. I don't know about doing the rounds. I mean, I haven't been called in to write the next Twilight movie. Right. Nobody's asked me to do that. But I've met some really smart, interesting, creative people.
You have an agent now that you probably didn't have a year ago.
I do. Yeah, Sundance Institute set me up with my agent, who I love. They're great.
And so, I mean, have you done the meetings, though, where they, you know, are talking about Twilight 8?
You know, I was fortunate, I think, because Sundance really helped me handpick the agent I'm with now, Sandra Lucchese. Nobody makes a bad match with me, even in the meetings. I mean, I think people who see the movie understand. I don't know. I don't think they'd hire me to write a Twilight movie, and I say that with great love for those movies. And I think they're really, you know, I love a lot of really good movies.
Bad movies too. Okay.
No, I do love bad movies too. Smoky Mountain Christmas, I think, is an unsung classic. That's my favorite holiday movie.
So do you have an interest in trying that out? I mean, do you have an interest in putting that cloak on and writing for money and writing, or for, you know, a job, a circumstance? Interesting to you?
I'm interested in telling great stories, and I think they can be in a lot of different forms. I think a well-told story can fit anywhere and is welcome anywhere. I know that I do know what I like writing about, so I'll just leave it at that. I really like working with the people that I trust and who challenge me the way that working with Ben challenges you and brings out the best. I'm interested in
not yet.
More
is
of that.
Is the answer. I mean, it sounds like you're not wanting to bite the hand to feed you, or might feed you next year, but at the same time, it doesn't sound like you're interested in kind of like hopping into, rewriting lifestyle or whatever.
Right. I think
I could easily see you being brought into Hunger Games to, you know, beef up the girls' roles or whatever.
I love Hunger Games. I love Hunger Games. Yeah. I mean, I think I just want to keep doing what I love, and I'm not really sure what the future holds, but I'm open.
So when you got to Sundance last year, I guess you were expecting the response that you guys got, pretty much?
No. I had no idea what it was supposed to look like. So even the response afterwards, I think Ben and I both were just thinking, well, that's just how people here are really supportive. Like, they're just so positive, and that's just how it is. But yeah, it was an incredible response. I mean, just the, and not just, I mean, the support from the independent film community was so overwhelming and positive and warm to get.
So was that, was there a point at which it went from being kind of, this may just be the way things are, to, oh, something special is actually happening here that's game-changing?
No, you know, I think I still, I think a standing ovation at Cannes, maybe that was the first moment, because I'd been warned so much that they'd boo you, and they move the seat so that it snaps up so that you know that they don't like it. And so I was really steeling myself for that. And, you know, we've had so much and we've come so far, and I'm just so grateful. And then when we got that, it was, you know, but,
So you were still waiting to be hated 4 months later, 5 months later.
Yeah, I was just told that I would be, so I was ready for it. I can, you know, it's like being the runt of fourth grade and knowing you're gonna get beat up that day, and just like you're ready for it.
And then you got love instead.
Yeah, then you get hugs.
You get asked to the school dance.
Yeah, exactly. So no, I mean the whole thing, but too, it's been so. I know I keep using the word humbling, but the people that we've met, even just in the audiences, talking about their relationships to the movie, talking about what they see of themselves and the characters, and just their own experiences with their children and with their parents, you can't get too hung up on yourself, because what they're bringing is so moving and interesting, and it's the reason we do it.
Well, I saw you, I think we met for about 10 seconds, which is fine that you don't remember it. Oh, the pain. But
no, where?
At the Searchlight party. No, at the Searchlight Christmas party recently.
Oh, wait, and the one in New York?
No, the one here at whatever that restaurant was. And you just had this giant smile on your face the whole time. And it was like everybody else, I was, you know, kind of having conversations, being polite. But you were like, you actually seemed to be happy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, because this, I really never expected this. And this doesn't happen to any other playwright that I know. So it's all... I was reading this Raymond Carver, this book of Raymond Carver poems that he put together, and I think he has this on his tombstone, but he was talking about recovering from alcoholism, and he almost died from it, and then he came back, and he fell in love with Gallagher, and he was able to write some of his best poems, and he said, it's all gravy after, and he's talking about his recovery, after I came back, it's all gravy. So it just feels like that I got to make the movie with Ben, who's my best friend, that I got to, and then that I got to watch so many people bring everything they have to it. It just feels like that was what I got. I mean, that's what I'm happy about. And then everything since then has just been overwhelming, humbling, kind, and I'm just so happy about it.
So do you have any fear? Of course I have to bring up fear. The other two dropping? I mean ultimately now you are, like it or not, you are a commodity in this culture of movies that we have, and you know, people will see you in a very different way. You now actually are a, you know, a known entity.
Uh-oh.
As it were. If you're an Oscar nominee, even more so, if you're, you know, as these things come along, does that concern you, or is it just kind of like go through life and see what happens next and just kind of take the ride?
Yeah, I think I'm just gonna go with it. I don't think, I mean, it's just been so enjoyable so far, and I think partially because we're able to really appreciate and enjoy every moment, and every new screening is just such a pleasure, and the people I get to talk to is so enjoyable that I'm just taking it day by day. So,
what do you do when you go home? You're going home. You're trying to go home.
I'm trying to go home. I am.
You can't go home again because you can't get a ticket.
No. I'm gonna bake a cake. I'm gonna bake this coconut lemon cake.
That's your holiday.
That's what I'm excited about. Yeah.
And will you be happy to have some quiet and not be talking about the movie every day?
I think I will be, though, because my mom loves to talk about it. My mom is so excited. And she gets excited by different people than I necessarily, not that I'm not excited by it, but she's just excited by different aspects of it. So it's all very cool to her.
So you're going home to your biggest fan.
To my biggest fan, my mom and my five dogs. Yeah.
It's like Kristen Stewart going home to Twilight fans or something.
Yeah, exactly.
You just can't get away from it. There's no escape.
Yeah.
And is there anything that you go at this point, okay, I'd like to be doing this 2 years from now or this 2 years from now? Or?
I want to just keep telling stories and keep making movies, making plays, and making music with people I respect and people who inspire me and challenge me.
So going back to the theater is likely at this
point? Oh, definitely. Yeah, I mean, I'm always going to write movies and I'm always going to write plays. I'd like to keep with music, which I've been exploring too, so.
And is there anything about the theater or going back to the theater that you're missing that you haven't, you know, now been invested a couple years in this movie?
No, honestly, it's felt very theatrical. I think because of the audience interaction and the audience response, mm-hmm. it's felt very, it feels like doing a play every night, which is maybe why I enjoy it so much.
It does feel, I mean, it's much more of an event movie than a traditional, you know, go to the movie theater, pay your $2 and, you know, $10, $20.
I know, it's like $14.
In New York, it's insane now.
So. Yeah.
And I think $14 for the soda is the really surprising part.
Yeah.
But I mean, it does have that sense of being an event that people want to talk about and inspires them to conversation.
Yeah.
Has anybody anything really crazy to say about it, or has it all been pretty, have people gotten it?
I think people for the most part get it. I mean, I try to stay off the internet as much as I can, so I don't know what.
So you can read about people writing about your hair color.
Yeah. Oh my God. I hope they don't. You know, who knows? But I, you know, that it makes me. It just helps me to interact with people one on one about it. So, they seem to get it. I mean, people talk about their families, their kids, where they're from.
So is this? Are you a part of the disconnected generation? Are you?
Oh, I don't know.
Smart enough not to be on that endless cycle of Twitter and Facebook? And
yeah, I don't know how to use Twitter, but that says more about, you know, that's not about my own discerning taste and more that I just don't know how to do it. And
but see, everybody would assume you're like the hippest chick in
Brooklyn. Oh, well, I'm not hip at all. I'm really not cool at all. I like to do yoga and get up in the morning and write. That's
so you walk
like
down a red carpet and you know, everybody takes your picture and then you're still feeling like a nerd on the inside?
Oh yeah, I have my Converse in my bag and I just put those on at the end of, because my feet are, I have size 10 feet, so it hurts to walk in heels for more than 20 minutes.
But it's so dramatic.
Yeah, absolutely. So I can stand and then I just put my sneakers back on.
So that's your plan for the Independent Spirit Awards?
That's my plan for everything, yeah.
Take them off, put on the sneakers, get back to life.
Yeah, exactly.
And sounds like your plan for your work and everything else.
Yeah, I mean, I'm very fortunate to be able to do what I love all the time. And especially now on the road, just being with my best friends all the time. So I've got a great life. I can't complain.
You still haven't been corrupted yet.
I know.
I mean, I'm sure that there are people who want to corrupt you.
I don't know. I've been fortunate that I haven't met anybody really
who admits it in public.
That's true.
But the thing is, it's like the thing is when you go through a situation like this, and you particularly when you know you feel it's like burst out of a surprise moment in your work, then all of a sudden there theoretically for people there's something to lose, and it doesn't seem like you're considering or wondering about or even concerned worried about the idea of, you know, losing position or having position. You just seem to be cruising.
Yeah, I mean, we made this movie with nothing to lose in the first place because we weren't. I mean, it's our first movie. It's their first feature. It's my first movie, short or feature length. So, I think it's just an incredible good fortune that we have, that people are so responsive to it. But yeah, I'm just enjoying it.